I want to welcome you all to the MD2K's seminar. This is part of the BD2K's center grant. And our speaker today is Steven Steinhubl. Steven is Director of Digital Medicine at the Scripps Translational Science Institute. And he is also a cardiologist at Scripps. He is probably one of the most popular speakers at our annual mHealth Training Institutes and has been generous enough to come and talk to us today about the Participant Technology Center, which is this very ambitious project by NIH to recruit a million patients. Steven's group will be heading the recruitment of 350,000 patients. And Steven, we are very excited to have you with us.
Thank you, Vivek. I appreciate the opportunity and good day to everybody based on your time zones or where you are. It's morning here still on the Pacific Coast. And it's a pleasure to talk to everybody. I want to start with my disclosures, which really don't affect any of this, anything I'm going to be talking about in this. Want to share and we'll make a comment about my unsuccessful history as a medical advisor and how it's the kiss of death for most companies. So don't pay much attention to that. So I'm going to cover a couple of key items, talking about the All of Us program, which is super exciting. And we're thrilled at Scripps to be part of such a really monumental process. So I want to give first a very brief introduction to precision medicine. Secondly, talk a little bit about the overall vision for the program, and then go over the design at a high level. And then when I was thinking about this talk, I thought that in the last, I'll talk about some select challenges. Well, came long enough where I just wanted to focus on one challenge, and that one challenge you'll see could be an entire different talk on its own, but I want to at least introduce it because I'm hoping that would help me decrease the nightmares associated with that challenge that I have. All right, so let's start with just a simple definition, which we still get a lot, and I think that there are many different definitions that are used. I'm going to use the NIH's, which is an emerging approach for disease treatment and prevention that takes into account individual variability in genes, environment, and lifestyle for each person, which is very good, and it does cover everything and all the components of it. But as a clinician, and for all of us as who at some time in our lives are going to be patients also, what I like this very straightforward. It's just really understanding that the patient is a unique human being in every aspect, in their physiological responses to the exact same stimuli as others, and in their emotional processes and everything. It's really understanding that uniqueness of them. And so this definition is from 1969, it's just one of the earlier, was talking about precision or individualized medicine. But really, if historically, if you go back and look, you know, Hippocrates, so several thousand years ago, is, you know, I think said it very well about what precision medicine is. It's saying it's being more important to know about what person the disease has than what disease the person has. And I think that is in much of what we do in healthcare today, it is the other way around. Even when, for those of you who are clinicians, when you're checking out or you're transferring care weekend, you know, it's you know, you're say this person is, you know, day three post heart attack. You know, so the person is defined by their condition rather than the other way around. And that is the reality today. And we do wonderful things, but I think we can do better. And then our definition or our perception, I should say, of precision medicine is based on what tools we have today. And I'm hoping 100 years from now, people talking about precision medicine or something like it will have a very different perception of what precision medicine is. This is Dr. Mitchell gave a talk in 1891 to kind of focus on the what he was referring to early history of instrumental precision in medicine. And what he was talking about, you can see the quote here, I'll confine myself almost entirely to the story of the early efforts to attain accuracy by instruments in the study of pulse, respiration, and temperature. So really, it's a beautiful essay that was talking about how wonderful it was in the late 1800s to have the ability to accurately measure temperature, something that wasn't routinely did, that like a lot of other technologies at the time was scoffed at initially, saying, well, you know, doctors can tell much better by just putting their hand on somebody's forehead or otherwise, and then also counting the pulse accurately and the respiratory rate accurately as a way to really more precisely identify the health or wellness of an individual. So we've obviously come a really long way in a little bit over 120 years. And again, I'm hoping that we'll have the same strides over the next 100 and plus years. But today we have remarkable tools, and nothing probably better exemplifies that than our ability to do genomic analysis. And this is a curve that there's many iterations that many have seen of just this, you know, really remarkable decrease in cost for whole genome sequencing that's occurred over time from the Human Genome Project to today. And there's no reason to think we've plateaued out and we're not going to go further. So our ability to understand the human genome is certainly a huge push behind the effort of better changing the way we think of healthcare and medicine and being more precise and understanding the genomic influence. But also a lot of else has changed that allows this. And I'll use as a kind of my starting point when I trained in cardiology, which was starting in mid to late 1990s. So when I started my cardiology fellowship, world's fastest supercomputer, 1.8 teraflops, cost $55 million, filled a room, took the electricity of 800 homes. And today, the first mobile teraflop processor is available to be implemented in. So in the time of my cardiology career, in that time, we've gone from, you know, supercomputer computational capability limited to only governments and large institutions to now being available or very soon being available in everybody's smartphone. We have incredible improvements in cognitive computing capabilities. So again, when I was a fellow is when Deep Blue beat Garry Kasparov. Today, you can download a similar chess playing program on your smartphone, and the ability of cognitive computing has gone well beyond just playing chess. As you know, Jeopardy and Google's AI winning at Go. And then finally, you know, another huge change is how connected we all are. So again, when I was a fellow, less than 0.5% of the population of the world had internet access. Today, it's 40% globally and almost 90% in the US. And as you can see by the curve, the majority of that growth is increasing by mobile technology, and that is growing. So by 2020, it's estimated that 100% of the adult population in the U.S. will have a smartphone, and it's globally, it's growing even more. So we're becoming more and more connected with greater and greater computational capability, and that computational not only power brings with it great cognitive capability. And then on top of that, you have an incredible plethora of health medical grade devices being developed that are able to measure new physiological measurements that were never possible before. Continuous measurements of stress, continuous measurements of sweat uptake, and then things that could be measured before but could be measured only in an intensive care unit or in a doctor's office, but now can be routinely measured at home. And these are just some select pictures of multiple devices. But really what's out there, and as so many smart and talented engineers, developing technologies that just address virtually every need. And some of them are not great right now. Some of them are just amazing. And there's a wide range in between. But what's super exciting about all of this is that this is a ongoing moving target. And whatever is state of the art today is going to be old news 6 months from now in virtually all of these fields, because the sensors get better. They get more unique, they get less expensive, they get more wearable, they get a lot of wrong time. And so it's a remarkable time to start taking advantage of these to really focus on how we can improve care. And let me just give an example, again, use my kind of my career a little bit as a barometer of this, of what can this really mean? So when I was in medical training, in medical school and in residency, unless, you know, there you had lung cancer, you had colon cancer, and for lung cancer, it was broken down, adenocarcinoma, squamous cell carcinoma, large cell carcinoma. So the very first breakdown of any kind of driver, genomic driver of cancer was in 1987. We found in a very small percentage a known driver, but the vast majority were unknown. But now over time, it's almost getting passé to refer to cancer based on the organ it was found in, but rather we're getting much more knowledgeable about what the mutation is, what the driver is for that cancer, as you can see today. And with that, we're able to, instead of, you know, giving individuals essentially by guessing at what quote unquote poison we should be giving somebody as a chemotherapy agent based on what organ that cancer initiated in, we can now specifically look at what genetic abnormality is driving this cancer and then what therapeutic intervention do we have that specifically addresses that abnormality. And you know, we're still in the infancy in cancer, but it's one of our best measures of what the potential is here and truly kind of life-saving advances that we've been able to have, that we can, with more and more knowledge, we'll be able to expand that. And I'll give an example in chronic condition management, which right now we're back where we were in the 1980s, I think, when it comes to cancer, where somebody gets a diagnosis, and for diabetes, except for the very broad differentiation of type 1 and type 2, that really treatments vary very little at the beginning, especially in the type 2 setting. And it's really not based on any individual information, either genomic or rarely even environmental information, other than maybe what your insurance is able to reimburse. And it's it's already a huge problem, and it's becoming a greater and greater problem globally. And we know there are numerous genomic markers associated with diabetes that we know that vary based on an individual's race and ethnicity and their background, but we don't know enough yet of how that could or should impact prevention, risk management, and then eventually, if necessary, treatment. We also know there's great variability. This is just one example of seven individuals wearing continuous glucose monitors who have diabetes, who would all have the exact same hemoglobin A1C level. So have, you know, in terms of our current state of our care of an individual, would say, okay, these people each all have equally good control of their glucose levels. But you can see, you know, remarkable variation over time for each of these individuals. And with wearable technologies, and particularly as we get to the point where we can have non-invasive continuous monitoring capabilities, we can really differentiate and better target the right therapies for the right people, and not only medication therapies, but also dietary and activity interventions. And diabetes is just one example of many chronic conditions, hypertension, atherosclerosis, COPD, many others. And I'll conclude in the precision medicine, where I just use as an example of where I think we can go. And, you know, obviously medicine, very complicated, very difficult to predict. But if you look at in the early 1900s of weather forecasting, that was really the beginning of using, you know, new data to predict weather. So in this, Dr. Richardson used barometric pressure, wind and temperature to start predicting weather. Well, today we have a wide array of sensors, you know, in the ocean, in the air, satellites on the ground, and we take all of that information. We use major computational capabilities through a supercomputer center to generate, you know, vast predictive maps that gives us information that we've never had available before. And the upside of that is now we can predict weather forecasting 350% more accurately than we could 25 years ago. And again, that's only getting better as we learn more. And you know, this is life-saving. And I think by collecting data, understanding it better in precision medicine, we'll be able to do the same. We'll have much better predictive accuracy in who's going to develop a condition, or how do you prevent a condition for this specific individual. You know, we've proven we could do it in other areas, and we're just starting down the path to getting much more focused on doing that in healthcare. So let me turn now to the really what is the vision of the precision medicine program. And many of you who are on this, listening to this, I'm sure are interested in this and are aware, but this started really with a big push by President Obama. But what many people don't realize is that he actually sponsored a bill in, before he was president in 2007 around precision medicine. And so he's remarkably engaged with this. And you know, he was a major driver of getting this along with Francis Collins. And it says, precision medicine gives us one of the greatest opportunities for new medical breakthroughs that we have ever seen. And very much believe that's true. This has become, you know, really the largest, most ambitious medical research program ever undertaken. The mission, which always excites me, is to enable a new era of medicine through research, technology, and policies that empower patients, researchers, and providers to work together towards development of individualized care. What I really like about this mission statement is it doesn't say to enable new clinical research as the lead. It's really to enable a new era of medicine. So what we're doing in the Precision Medicine Initiative, and specifically the All of Us program, is really to serve as a model for the way medicine can be provided in healthcare can be provided in the future. So not just a pure research study to collect data, but really to change the practice of healthcare. The core values is what drives almost every decision, essentially every decision that's made in the All of Us program. And for those who are involved in clinical research, we recognize right away that these are very different and very transformational. We'll go into some details, but it's really important to emphasize because there are so many unknowns in the development of the All of Us program, Precision Medicine Initiative. And in all the decision-making, it always comes down to, okay, how is it reinforcing our core values? So is it allowing participation to be open to all? Is it reflecting America's rich diversity? Are participants being treated as partners? Will they have full access to their information? Is this an open resource? How do we make this available to everybody? How do we assure privacy and security for everybody? And then how do we make sure this is a catalyst for positive change, not just a way to collect a lot of data and publish papers? So let me focus on some of the key aspects of it. So really, a transformational approach to including a diverse population. So we really want to, reflect to really improve our knowledge of healthcare. We really have to understand the genetic variability, the socioeconomic variability, the environmental exposure variability that all of us within the U.S. kind of live with. But in the past, a lot of people involved in clinical research had the capability, happened to live next to an academic medical center. But for various reasons, important portions of our population have been excluded, which has limited what we can learn about how do we really improve healthcare. And so there's a very big focus on diversity. There's also a huge focus, as mentioned, on participation. That nothing makes me feel more uncomfortable now after 8 months of working on this with the All of Us team if I accidentally slip and say patients instead of partners. But as Chloe said, they're not the individuals participating in this program are not patients. They are not subjects. They are partners in this. And again, any of you who's involved in clinical research saying that's really easy to say. But to actually do that is remarkably transformational and challenging. But as a core value, we focus all of our decision on making sure we do that. So they guide not only, telling us, what's of interest to them, but, in really the details, what data we collect, the lab analysis, what are the research focuses, how do we return the data, what data to return, and how do we share that? And the whole process would be as we start enrolling individuals to get those people more and more involved, the participants more and more involved who wish to be in guiding them. It's also a very transformational approach to data access. This isn't just the grant awardees and Scripps and Vanderbilt and Mayo Clinic and others aren't the only people who are going to have access to the data. This is really designed to be available to everybody, including citizen scientists. And I'll go into more details on this, the Vanderbilt-led team with the Broad Institute and Verily, who are doing this, but making sure that data sharing is available to researchers and participants. The participants have access to all their data and study information, again, privacy and security, and then really not just making it available, but making it easily available, especially to researchers who have had much more difficulty of getting involved. And I like in this, in the figure on here, community college, high school investigators, there are a lot of smart researchers who never get access because they don't have the big grant. They're not at the big research academic institution where they have access to it. And this is really designed to change that. And then the program data, we want to collect information that we've never really been able to collect before on a large cohort. And so we're going to collect a limited data set. And as I'll go through when I talk about the actual design of what we're doing, what we have right now is a resource. We don't have the specifics. So everything we're doing now, that nothing is set in stone. Everything is dynamic. But right now we know we're going to collect a lot of participant-provided information through surveys and questionnaires. Everybody is going to link their electronic health record as soon as they're able to. People are going to be invited, participants are going to be invited to undergo a baseline physical evaluation, to provide biospecimens, to eventually be asked to wear certain mobile devices, wearable technologies based on studies, as well as provide geospatial and environmental data. But as the bottom line says, the data types will grow and evolve. And so there, very little is set in stone, and I'll go through that in the design, which is our next section now. So here, taking this slide, that's the entire overview of the design of the program. Well, just give you seconds to review that, and I'll go into the details of it. But it's a very huge network, overall, obviously led by the NIH, doing this, but with an incredible team in all of these boxes and beyond that are allowing them to make this happen. And let me give some details. But first, I'll start with some caveats. I already mentioned that what is designed so far is only a research resource. There's no actual research study. So you won't find me, I won't be mentioning we're going to be doing these genomic studies. People will be getting this sensor because we don't know what that is yet. So we know we're going to do those things. We just haven't finalized what we're going to do. And what we're going to do initially is not what is going to be different from 2 years from now and 4 years from now. The other important thing is there's a lot of smart people listening to this who will have a lot of really good questions, but there are a lot of there are limited answers to those questions now. So we spend a lot of times with a lot of hundreds of very smart, very passionate people trying to figure out how we're going to deal with things that have frankly never been dealt with before and figuring out the best ways to do that. Everything we do, though, is designed as a learning system. So none of us are going into this saying we know the right way to do this and we're just going to implement it and darn it, make it work. Instead, it's really designed. We're going to implement it. We're going to learn from it. We're going to alter things that aren't working, and we're going to make sure we keep learning and keep refining over time. So on the big picture, there are two methods of initial engagement to become part of the All of Us program. The healthcare provider organizations will be in charge of the bulk of the enrollment of 650,000 individuals. Then there's another 350,000 individuals who will be enrolled as direct volunteers. And so that's going to lead to, as we say in our protocol, at least 1 million individuals. That doesn't mean we're going to stop enrollment at 1 million, but that's just what our target is right now. And again, as we learn and through the process that we'll do, but 2/3 will be coming in through healthcare provider organizations and 1/3 through direct volunteers. Now, I'll add some color to how that's broken down. This is a map of our current healthcare provider organizations, and what's listed are just the lead organizations. Underneath all of these are other centers. So, for example, the University of California, San Diego is the California Consortium, which includes UCSF, UC Irvine, Cedar-Sinai, and others. The Columbia University also includes Harlem Hospital. So all of these are actually a consortium of different healthcare systems and models. The Henry Ford system stretches across much of the Americas and in with their partner organizations. So it covers more than just these cities where you'll see the markers or the dots, but in a broader swath. But these are the regional medical centers. So that's one component of the HPOs. A second component of the healthcare provider organizations, HPOs, are the federally qualified health centers. We have these six centers that are developing and pilot health center approaches for enrolling specifically these underserved populations, and especially those underrepresented in biomedical research. So they've been tremendous collaborators in putting this together, are going to be a very important part of the enrollment. And then finally, the final major HPO are the VA medical centers. This is in collaboration. Many of you may be familiar with their Million Veterans Program, which has a lot of overlap in what we're, the All of Us program is focusing on. And then they anticipate about 20 participating VA centers will be part of the All of Us program. And that makes up the two-thirds enrollment partners for the HPO component. And then for us at Scripps, where we're fortunate enough to be in charge of the direct volunteer program, we have outreach partners. So really eclectic and wonderful group to work with. So WebMD and Walgreens, most are familiar with, Wondros and HCM and Montage Marketing are incredible outreach groups. And then Blue Cross Blue Shield, which insures one-third of all Americans. And then the National Blood Collaboration across the country, a collaborative of blood banks, which has an incredible network of volunteers and altruistic individuals. And all of those, we have, you know, working with them for various outreach strategies to reach out to the direct volunteer community. Once we reach out and people are interested in enrolling, and I'll walk through that process, then after signing informed consent, we need to bring them to enrollment centers. And we have five partners working with to do that. So the four shown here are brick and mortar partners. And again, Walgreens is a great example beyond our outreach partners and their incredible marketing capability. They also have a string of clinics, and these are just the starting clinics. They have hundreds more that can be expanded to as the program grows. QTC, Elido's company, has over 13,000 affiliated providers across the country. Quest Diagnostics has over 3,000 across the country. And then the National Blood Collaboration has a scattering of the blood banks, as I mentioned. For people who are not close enough or cannot make it to a brick and mortar facility, then our final partner is EMSI Health. They are a organization that has been involved in several prior NIH studies where they go direct to an individual's home to do enrollment. So if you imagine their, their business model is built when they're not doing research around doing insurance physicals in the home. And so they have outreach to everywhere in the country, not just where these dots are, where they have regional centers, but they essentially can go to any zip code, any house, anywhere to enroll. So the idea is to make it enrollment available to anybody, anywhere in the country, not limited to their location to a healthcare provider organization. Now, the whole process, once somebody is interested, at least at the very beginning, all information or the majority of information, especially for the direct volunteers, the enrollment will be digital. So individuals will be led to an informational website to find out more. From the informational website, they have the opportunity to read through frequently asked questions. They can call a support center and ask questions, or they can go through to the enrollment site. And then if they're interested, they can go down the consent process, which is, again, a purely digital consent process. For those of you familiar with like research kit consents, it's really broken down in a very user-friendly way, and I would say an understandable way, as opposed to the typical, six-page printed legal document that is the norm in clinical studies. And I just have some select screenshots so every point as you walk through, you can agree or you can find more information, watch a video to get more information about that specific aspect of your data or your security and your privacy and the risks and the benefits. And then eventually, once you sign the consent, you are welcome to the All of Us Research Program, where you start being led down the path to of the information to go through the survey questionnaires, to schedule a baseline evaluation, and to start kind of your long-term engagement process within the All of Us program. For the baseline evaluation, so once somebody signs the informed consent and enrolls, they will be directed, if they're in an HPO, they'll be directed to their healthcare provider organization. If a direct volunteer, it will be based on their location, be sent to an enrollment center where they'll have a baseline physical measurements taken that include a very straightforward just blood pressure, pulse, height, weight, waist circumference, and hip circumference. They'll also have their blood draw. So right now there's six tubes of blood and one tube of urine being collected, as shown in the table here. For individuals who either refuse to have their blood drawn, or more if they kind of tolerated two attempts at drawing blood and have been unsuccessful, then there'll be a saliva backup program for DNA specimens. After the baseline evaluation or within it, there are also some participant-provided information, PPI. Right now, there are seven modules that, again, like everything in the program, that's dynamic. But there are seven initial modules where the PPI working group's been working through. And this, again, will be all done digitally. Sociodemographic information, personal health history, medications, overall health, personal habits, family history, healthcare access, and utilization questionnaires. And this will be presented to individuals in a way that doesn't overwhelm them and allows them time to kind of go through and fill all of these out, but with prompting and asking them to make sure to complete all seven of these. And then once we're collecting this data, so the provider, the participant provided information, the baseline evaluation data, and then everybody will also be asked to link their electronic health record information to data, and that's going to be handled as well as all of the other data through the Data and Research Corps, which I mentioned is being led by Vanderbilt, Broad Institute, and Verily. The HPOs already have that mechanism built in. For the direct volunteers, that's right now is going to be dependent on Sync for Science going through, getting through its pilot testing program and being more widely available. We're also exploring other potentials as the environment for personal health records is growing, and the availability we know will be growing in the next upcoming years, where allowing individuals to link in that matter, but so that overall at the Data and Research Corps will be the keepers of all of that data that's being collected here at the time of enrollment. But then as we do more and more studies in the future, that those will include, the sensor data, the genomic data, and other information that's being collected, future participant-provided information. I had mentioned about making the data useful. I want to thank Josh Denny, who is the co-chair and co-PI of the study, for these slides. So I mentioned we really wanted the Data and Research Corps is going to be supporting a diverse family of researchers. And every aspect of the research core is designed to do that. There's obviously going to take a lot of creativity. Right now, the vision is that there's going to be essentially three pathways to work with the data within the Data and Research Corps. At the highest level will be approved users with approved protocols. So in researchers who submit protocols and get IRB approval will get the greatest depth of information, including individual level data. Registered users will have to go through a training process and agree to use of terms. We'll have more aggregate data access, and then all users, citizen scientists and the like, will have summary data available for the program and have insights and all that. But again, all of it's going to be open to all researchers. All researchers will have the capability of choosing their tier of enroll or involvement in looking at the data access. And again, irrespective of whether you're a grantee on the All of Us program or not. And then the Vanderbilt and entire data research core team is building tools to really make it easier to bring the researcher to the data, make that data easily accessible and searchable so that you can do, you know, you don't have to write a protocol just to find out that, the kind of patients you're looking for or the type of individuals you're looking for aren't within there. So you can do essentially prep to research kind of analyses, and then with the approved protocol, get really down on the participant view. So you can filter cohorts, then you get down to the participant view with a approved protocol, and then having other tools to really help, you know, on a really granular level, look at everything that you want to be able to look at for whatever your study is, what the things that you can't even think of today. So a lot of work being put into this to develop this resource and get it up and running. And right now, we're the program is planning for a soft launch to start enrolling individuals in kind of a pilot phase in late April, so in the next several months, with a more a broader national rollout in the summer based on how the pilot phase is going. And then once we get going, it'll start escalating very quickly with what we hope is completing enrollment over the next 4 to 5 years. But again, we're going to be learning a lot as we do that. And as we learn, we're going to refine and get better and better. So in these final couple minutes, I just want to, as I mentioned, there are a couple of challenges I want to talk about, but I really want to focus on what I think is going to be one of the biggest challenges, and that's going to be, long-term retention. Some of the best examples, and actually when we talk about the All of Us program, it's often referred to as the Framingham study of today, of the 21st century. And the reason is because Framingham was so transformational, was so great. Many was started in the 1940s. It helped us learn a lot of things about the association of high cholesterol, of smoking, of hypertension, and its impact on diseases. And really, this is the next step. Well, one of the reasons Framingham was so successful is its longitudinal ability to have longitudinal follow-up of individuals over decades and decades. But by definition, the Framingham study included individuals living in a town with 2 year set follow-up. So a very strong sense of community, a very strong altruistic sense of involvement in that study. Now we have to try to duplicate that in a sense using primarily just digital involvement. Now the healthcare provider organizations will have access to participants, but and we'll have that relationship, but people move. And we really, even though this is right now looking to be, you know, by design a 10-year program, well, to be really successful, I think all of us involved in it would like to be a 40 and 50-year program and keep learning and keep getting better over time. So really the key is how do we keep people engaged over that? And I'll give this example of a tremendous program. This is the Empower Research Kit program. Out of the University of Rochester with Sage BioNetworks support, you know, very nice study in Parkinson's individuals, some simple tests that can be done on the phone. When this was announced, a lot of enthusiasm, almost 50,000 people downloaded the app, over 16,000 consented right away. Of those, a little bit less than 10,000 agreed to share their data broadly, which are the group that we'll do further looking at. But of that 9,520, only less than 900, just less than 900 actually contributed data on at least 5 separate days over the first 6 months. And of those 898, these are graphs of broken down by controls and the actual individuals with Parkinson's. You can see the vast majority of that was very early in the early days of that. So here you have a one digital study, you know, very user-friendly, very easy to use, smartphone-based, a lot of enthusiasm, 50,000 people enthusiastic enough to download it, 16,000 excited enough to sign the informed consent. But really, you end up with just a very tiny percentage of individuals, so only 10% of people we have data on who used it more than 5 times. But even for those, the vast majority in the last several days. So if this is kind of a benchmark for digital engagement, how do we expand that to decades and decades? And that's the great thing. We're working with a lot of smart people to help figure that out, but we have to figure it out. And we have to figure that out as a learning system. And a lot we say, well, you know, say, well, we'll just give people all of their information. And which is not, and obviously that is, we want to share data with individuals. We want to make data available to individuals. But that's, in my mind, and this is me speaking, I'm not speaking for the program, or none of this, I should have said I'm speaking for the program. Fine, but, you know, it's one thing to say the data is available. It's another thing to say we're going to share all the data with individuals, because I think there's a lot of good data. Which suggests that if we just push everybody's health information to them, that isn't necessarily a desirable situation from the beginning, that we may actually disincentivize people. This is just one small study, but it happens to be consistent with what I had one of my earliest patients in my career who told me, they don't like being reminded we're sick. And this program is open not just to the quantified self or marathon runner who's really good at tracking everything, and in fact we want a small percentage of those, but people with, ideally with multiple chronic conditions. So we can't anticipate just pushing information to people and say, hey, your glucose is this, your blood pressure is this, your this is your weight and things. We have to be, I think, really clever and really rethink how we share all the information we're going to be sharing. In this study, again, as their conclusion, you know, that a lot of it sometimes, I would put in even here researchers, but health information technologies just assume patients have unlimited enthusiasm for tracking their own health data. And you can tell by the title of the thing is that they found otherwise, that, you know, most people in this small study found it was a lot of work to track their own data. So anything that we do, we have to not assume that people are going to be enthusiastic about tracking a lot of stuff actively. We're going to try to have to make things as passive as possible. We have to be aware that the data we're sharing with are going to be emotionally charged. And then also we, you know, as this is all geared towards participants, but at the same time, we have to make sure that the provider organizations of the country outside of just the HPOs, but that are on board and understand what we're doing, that we're not trying to usurp their relationship, but actually more empower that. And that's also a challenge on its own too. So I think we have a lot to learn. And a reminder of this, my colleague, friend, boss, Eric Topol tweeted this yesterday, and I never understand how he finds all the things he finds, but I found this really fascinating. So this is the psychology of not wanting to know. And in this study done in Spain and Germany, where they looked at people wanting to know or not, what they're called deliberate ignorance. And what was amazing is the high percentage of people. So 85 to 90% of people would not want to know about upcoming negative events. And 40 to 70% prefer to remain ignorant of even positive events. So negative events would include like, return of genetic information that says you have 4 times the subpopulation risk of developing Alzheimer's. You know, and so genetics being a huge component of this, as well as others. So let's say we find a marker for the pre-diabetes, which is great. You know, that'll allow us to treat something. And to implement risk factor modification, but we have to be careful how we communicate that. We just can't share that and want people to stay engaged for decades and decades. And you'll see in the bottom line, only 1% of participants consistently wanted to know everything. And so I think as we think, and again, we have a tremendous team, not only within Scripps, but our partners outside of Scripps and throughout the All of Us program, thinking about this and learning and developing this and realizing there's not going to be one solution that's going to fit a million individuals. There's going to be a solution that is going to fit a small subset of individuals. And our goal is to try to mesh that in terms of follow-up with the individual. And then finally yesterday, the All of Us program announced the hiring or the of a chief engagement officer, Dr. Richardson Heron, which is going to be super exciting and just shows, you know, how important this is to have that engagement and to figure that out. we're going to need a lot of leadership and a lot of help, and we have a lot of work to do. And again, even though we're kind of focused on this, we're going to need a lot of input from the outside research community to make this the long-term engagement and really every aspect of this program successful. So in conclusion, I think we have really a lot of audacious goals to make this happen, and that's what makes this exciting. And most of the time, but every now and then, you know, anxiety producing. But we aim to, the goal of this is to generate a new model of research based on collaboration among researchers, providers, participants. We want it to be a rich resource of data, including biospecimens and EHR data and digital technology data that's going to accelerate research advances. And the bottom line is we want to increase knowledge that leads to individualized care and improving health for future generations. So I really appreciate everybody taking the time to listen. It's been an honor not only to work and be part of the All of Us program, but to, on behalf of hundreds of people who have worked incredibly hard on this, to give you just a brief introduction to it.
Steve, thank you for a terrific 40,000 feet view of this very exciting project and program. We applaud you and Eric Topol for taking the lead and the burden of literally herding cats. Before I want to turn it over to the audience now.
Hello, Shahin Sami here from Memphis. I had a question about the human subjects component of the research that will be done primarily with the individual level data. And I know that there's been a lot of movement towards the single IRB model that's been promulgated by, of course, by NIH, and that the All of Us initiative seems like it really stands behind it. I was wondering if there's been any updates or any movement towards how to share that information with investigators to get them on board with how that process actually works.
Now, thank you for that question, and I really should have mentioned that in the slides. It's great. So the another very unique thing of the All of Us program, it has a dedicated IRB, single IRB, and every program that involves any research program that requires IRB oversight within the program has to go through that IRB program. And of the many thing moving parts, but the goal is as we get the platform more available and easily available to researchers like you, that we will make that much more streamlined. And in fact, part of our grant working with Sage BioNetworks, it has really led a lot of the work on the initial informed consent and a lot of the IRB protocol submission is working with investigators like you and others who have an IRB submission to help make that as streamlined as possible. So, for example, providing kind of a boilerplate protocol that meets the needs, that makes it easier for you to fill in what you need to do that. We don't anticipate that kind of being up and running for a year or so, just because we don't anticipate having enough participants in the program until, you know, that time to kind of start opening it up to broader studies. But that is definitely a part of it. And it'll be really unique working with a single IRB that has no other project other than the All of Us program. Thanks for the question, and I'm sorry I didn't bring it up in the talk.
Wonderful, thank you.
Steve, who is the contact point for researchers who are interested in intersecting with the All of Us program?
I guess it depends a little bit on what the question is, you know, what everybody's interest is. So, for example, Steve Thibodeau is in charge of the biobank from Mayo Clinic. Josh Denny at Vanderbilt is, he's overall lead, you know, but I don't want to flood his email box for that. But, you know, Data Research Core, us at Scripps, and please, anybody who has any question, and if I don't know the answer, I'm thrilled to pass it on to somebody else. But for anything, for the direct volunteers or the participant engagement aspects of it, that myself or Eric Topol would be the best. My email box isn't as full as Eric's. But anybody with any question about it, we can feel free to send to me, and I will forward to the right person.
Are you contemplating a kind of a unifying portal where people can.
Part of that for researchers in the future, we anticipate there will be a researcher portal that provides not only, okay, what's going on, so somewhere in the future where there's papers and stuff, where there's, a component of, to link with the people who you want to know to find out more information, if you will need to ask a question of somebody, or to even link to look at a summary data for different things at a high level, just to, satisfy your curiosity, how many people are enrolled within, from Southern California, and what's their breakdown, what information is there, that kind of stuff is all going to be available on a researcher portal. But that also, with the kind of the air thing, isn't anticipated to be up and available for a year or so.
Oh, I see.
It looks like we've got a chat question come in from Andrea Harrow. Did you mention your ideal target volunteer? Will you be marketing and looking for particular people?
Yeah, that's a great question too, and one I kind of purposely didn't answer because. In a way, the ideal target volunteer is representative of an individual who has historically been underrepresented in research trials. And I know that that's kind of not a true answer in a sense, but that is the reality. So, we're underrepresented in racial and ethnic diversity. We're underrepresented in, rural populations or remote populations, underrepresented in lower socioeconomic classes, specifically looking for individuals with multiple chronic conditions, people who are left out of research because they have too many comorbidities. That becomes a group of what are our ideal volunteers. And it's something that is going to be tracked very closely from the very beginning as we start enrolling to make sure we do that. I think most of us would consider it a huge failure if we've enrolled 100,000 people to find out that they're all upper middle class, mostly Caucasians who live, within driving distance of an academic medical center. So I want to close the chat box. They're asking too many good questions. Okay, so I see the next is, how do you think the current migrant policies and general environment around this would affect the involvement of these underrepresented populations? It's from Salvador. This is a really good question. And the honest answer is I'm concerned about that. Because as we, I should mention and didn't, that this trial, the program is open to anybody living within America. You don't have to be an American citizen, just anybody living within America. And if populations within America already feel that they are targeted for negative reasons, if we're, reaching out to them specifically to for good reasons, to get them involved in research, to learn more, to make sure we have a diverse population, it's not. It wouldn't be surprising if there's a little bit less trust in that in the intentions of the research project that's happening. And I'm especially sensitive about that because for the direct volunteers, we don't have that face-to-face relationship where I think you can build trust from that. For the direct volunteers, it's a lot of digital, and that makes it, much more challenging if you have a group that's already a little weary about, why are you talking to me? Why are you reaching out to me? And then trying to get those to be involved. So that's a great question that I think we're going to learn a lot as we start going.
And I think we will let Steve go catch the surf outside his window. Steve, thank you so much. This is was very enlightening, and I hope we can have you back as the All of Us program evolves and settles down to give us an update. So on behalf of the MD2K and the BD2K community, thanks again for coming and sharing your insights and your efforts with us, and we look forward to having you back at the mHealth Training Institute.
Always.
Thank you all.
Thank you, everybody. Have a good day.